What is up, everybody? This is the Thumb Throttle Podcast, number 3, episode 3. We're still going strong. We're still doing it. I'm your co-host, Colton Yankovich, and this is the host,
John Yankovich. That's pretty good. You found your voice. I'm proud of you.
Slightly.
Yeah, that's good. We got to keep it rolling. So, what you been up to so far since the last one? We're kind of putting them out regularly now. So, what have you been up to since the last one we put out?
Not much.
I know the weather's really
crappy. I know. Cannot ride at all.
I know. Every time we think we're able to ride, we get rain, snow, rain, a little bit of cold, more rain.
Then we have like 2 days of warm.
Yeah.
Still wet.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it's not been real conducive for riding. I'm looking forward to the weather kind of breaking so we can get out there. Getting finished up on your bike.
Well, I wouldn't say finished up.
Well, we're getting there.
Yeah, we're like one-fourth of the way there.
We
got the frame, we got the swing arm, we got the whole back end pretty much done. We got the front end done, except for the shocks. We're still waiting on the shocks.
Which who's getting us our shocks?
Micah from Custom Axis.
That's right. The best.
Dialing them in.
The best shocks in the industry, bar none.
Mm-hmm.
Micah's going to get us taken care of.
Cared of.
We're not professionals
we're
here.
No.
What do you expect from me?
Cared of.
So just looking forward to it. I got some new to use your slang, some new swag for the bike.
Swag.
Got some new GPS bead locks.
Mm-hmm.
And can't wait to put them on. Also got tire blocks.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I got tire blocks for you too.
Oh.
Yeah.
So thoughtful.
I know. But yeah, I want called up our sponsors at GPS Global Power Sports. They gave us the hookup on another set of wheels and some tire blocks. So we will be ready to hit everything that's gnarly and nasty out there and not even worry about it.
I can. I don't know if he can.
Just because I'm not hitting it at high speed doesn't mean I can't hit it.
You ain't gonna make it very far, though.
Well, yes, I will. I'll roll right through with the tire blocks.
Well, and with the tire blocks and the rims, I think you'll be fine, but I don't think you're gonna get very far because you're gonna run out of breath.
I will be fine. Speaking of which, how have you been doing on your workouts?
Good. Yeah, I've been missing a few lately because of school and all that, but...
Well, I'll cut you some slack on that because I think I missed one too. But it's when you're not used to doing something forever, then you start doing it. It takes a while. They say 27 days you have to do something for it to become a habit. So, other than that, working on the bikes, getting that everything dialed in. Now, the motor is going to be a little bit. I talked to Shoop. I told him we can wait probably till the end of February, which will be cutting it close. Our first race is the 18th, but
March 18th.
He's covered up with all his national bikes, and the GNCC is starting soon. So, you know, let him take that time and get them guys finished up and, you know, work on those national machines and, you know, after that, and then he'll get ours done. So I'm really looking forward to that.
The thing's going to rip.
Yeah, so hopefully the driver will rip too.
Yeah, I will. No doubt.
No doubt. So what are you looking forward to most this season?
Everything?
Mm-hmm. Well, I know you've been running around the house every time I turn around, I just hear a rev limiter. Nee, 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 nee. That's like your go-to sound. So hopefully, you know, in the near future, we can get the bikes out there, get some practice laps in, get out riding with some people, and get back into the swing of things. Although, I really like working on clean bikes. It's nice. Speaking of clean bikes, we get a new sponsor, too. Who's that?
Alco cleaning products.
That's right. So we got our first
top of the line.
We got our first shipment of Alco bike wash in.
We got bike wash, laundry stuff, and we got farm soap.
Yeah. I in order to smooth things over, I ordered laundry soap for Mom. I think it's probably a better product than what we use because
great value.
Yeah, I don't.
Or whatever it is.
Yeah, great crap is what it is. Crap. But we'll be dialed in for cleaning bikes. You'll be dialed in for cleaning bikes. So, I mean, that's what I got you. I got you four gallons of bike wash.
I saw the receipt. Four gallons of bike wash.
Yep.
Good soup.
So, we'll be sporting the clean, fresh bikes all the time now. There'd be no excuse for you. We'll just load up your foam cannon and you'll be off to the races. But, what else do we want to talk about? Let's see.
Another guest that we're going to have on.
Oh, yeah, we are going to have a guest, aren't we? Mm-hmm. Keeping with our theme of low-quality video productions.
Yep.
Low-quality in production, but really high-quality guest. Reached out to one of our contacts from FASST Company, Flex Handlebars, Logan Huff. Just a great guy that we got to meet last year. I've probably known him for about a year and a half now. And when I say know him, just been in contact with him. Feels like I've known him for a long time. Just a super great guy. And if any of you out there have dealt with flex bars or FASST in general and had questions, Logan's the guy that you've probably talked to. And he's probably helped you out with any question that you've had. Just a real knowledge, a wealth of knowledge as far as the handlebars go. And you know, he can get you set up and dialed in. And you're wearing the same FASST shirt again?
I washed it.
I find that hard to believe.
I washed it.
We really got to start doing video if you're going to start wearing all these sponsor products. Because we're missing out on opportunities.
Yeah, I got all my race stuff on. I got Fox sweatshirt, Fox sweatpants. I got my FASST shirt on.
Yeah, but we're not sponsored by Fox. Yeah, come on, dude. Like, this isn't your first rodeo.
Well, you need to give me a Leot or an O'Neill one.
You got money?
I don't feel like spending it. Race fees.
Oh, okay. I'll remind you of that when I tell you, hey, you got your race fees, and then I got to pay your race fees. No?
No.
Okay.
You won't have to remind me.
Okay. But, yeah, we're going to have Logan on here. And then we got a couple other people lined up. We got a surprise guest for next week.
Yeah.
So sometimes we record one or two conversations a week and then we put them out as we go because I am not the fastest or the most efficient at editing.
You're not the fastest at racing either.
Come on. That's not cool.
Well, it's true.
I'm working on it.
You're working on it.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's... Well, obviously, I'm not FASST at anything, so I can't do that.
Well, you're FASST at other stuff, but just not racing.
You're gonna cut yourself.
I know.
We're working on getting FASST in racing.
We're working.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, hey, I have nothing left to prove. Mm-hmm. The only thing I have to prove is that I can put you on a FASST bike, and I can fill it with gas.
You're not that good at that either.
Well, there's room for improvement there. So, so we'll have a surprise guest next week. I can get that together. We'll get on the phone here after we put this one together and get the footage for next week. Without any further ado, we'll cut to the interview with Logan.
Yep.
And, what else? Anything else?
No.
All right, so on the phone now, we're going to have Logan Huff from FASST Company.
All right, 34. So on the phone, we got Logan Huff. How you doing, Logan?
I'm doing great, John. How you doing, man?
Not too bad, man. I'm glad we got you on here. We've been trying to do this for a while, and for a while there, we had the whole idea of the podcast, and I kind of drug my feet on it. We finally did it, and then it's just been back and forth in race season and everything else. But, hey, you're here now, and we got you on, so I'm glad to have you, man. Thanks for coming on.
Yeah, thanks for having me, man. Like you were saying, yeah, it's definitely, we've been trying to get it going for a couple of weeks, but I'm sure we would have got something going had I been like a little more just available. You know how it is. Yeah, you're just talking. I mean, we're all busy, bro. It's all good.
Right.
We're here
right
now.
I'm off this week, so like I'm trying to line people up and do like 3 or 4 phone calls. I'm trying to tell them like, man, I might not get to it this week. It might be like 2 weeks or whatever it is, but it's just, yeah, it's, life happens. But hey, man, to the people willing to put in the extra work, all the spoils come, right?
Yes, that's right. Yeah, exactly. Life does not stop happening. It's crazy.
No, it's not. And what I've learned is whenever you think you got it figured out, you just better open your eyes because there's something coming.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, use it wisely. Don't be sitting around. You got to use that time to get ahead.
Right. This is one question that I ask everybody, and by everybody, I mean the other person I had on the podcast so far. How did you get started? And, you know, I can tell you how we got started, and we were really late to the game, like, you know, not like everybody else, but how did you get your start? And like, take me back to when little Logan first got on the four wheeler and tell me it was a four wheeler, not a dirt bike.
Yeah, so it was on a quad. I was probably four maybe five at the latest, but three to five years old, out in the backyard riding this little like Casilla 90. I don't know if you ever seen those, but they were just like old, it was a knockoff quad, you know? My buddy Kane Smead over at Dirt Wheels Magazine ended up hooking my dad up with that and a Kawasaki Lakota Sport. And those were our two quads, man. And we went out we just went camping as a family. And my dad made a couple, like, little dirt piles out in the backyard and kind of followed me around with a little, like, with a leash, you know, ran around and my mom would never let me ride it unless he was out there. He was always working, so I never really got to ride it.
Yeah.
So I guess, you know, a fire started developing there, you know, like when I only get to go ride 2 or 3 times a year, you know, and sit on the back of the quad when I was doing it, it was like, man, like, you know, we need to keep getting out here and doing this, you know? And, I lived in California at the time. And so I ended up moving up to Utah when I was 10. I'm 27 now, so I'm taking you way back. So I moved up to Utah when I was 10. And my dad ended up getting me a Raptor 250 when I was 11. And that was our fastest quad we had. It was sick, you know. Like, we just ripped that thing around. And I ended up finally getting comfortable on that thing. When I was like 15, I was like, it was like my life savings as a kid, you know. I had like $4,000, and I'm just like, Dad, I'm spending this. I need to get a 450. Like, I'm 15, and this thing is too slow, you know. So I ended up finally getting one. Yeah, I ended up finding one, and it was good, you know. It was just a big learning experience. It was a carbureted YFZ 450, and it looked sick. It was a dune quad. Dude didn't take a ton of good care of it, so kind of had some problems. And yeah, like I said, it was a learning experience. And my mom never let me race, so I still hadn't hit a race yet. Once I turned 17, I mean, I was pretty much, you know, I mean, at that point you'd start to grow into being a little bit more of an adult there. And then my dad was like, I already had plans of moving out. We had scheduled like school later on in the year in Phoenix in like November. He just took me to a couple races, I think, because he was like, all right, let's just get this going. And yeah, 17 and started racing. And I guess, this will be my 10th year racing, and probably the eighth. This year will be my 8th full season. I'm going to I'll be at every round. So
that's a little different from us, but I like how you said that, you know, you basically just started off riding. And I think that's one of my questions that I had, you know, that I wanted to ask people is like, you know, what can we do to grow the ATV racing or just ATVs in general? And like you said, it doesn't always have to start with racing. It's just going out there and doing things as a family. Like, I bought Colton his first quad. It was one of his Predator 50s. And I think he was three or four at the time. And just what a pile of crap that thing was. So, like I do, and, you know, my wife loves me for it. I convinced her that we needed another one. Because I thought, you know, he's not riding this thing because it's a piece of crap. It doesn't run half the time. So I went out and got him a TRX 90, came home, and he rode it for like 15 minutes, and the damn thing sat in the garage. I shit you not, for almost 2 years. And I'm like, dude, what are you doing? Like, if I had this when I was your age, I guarantee there would be nothing left of it right now. I'd have rode it so hard. It wasn't for lack of trying to get him out there, but the thing is, like, he had it. And, you know, we got some property, mm-hmm. So it's a lot easier for him to not feel that urge to take advantage of, you know, every second he gets to ride a bike because, I mean, other than the crappy weather that we have, he can ride any day of the week. Yeah, once he took to it, man, I couldn't get him off it. And, you know, he was like, Dad, I think I want a dirt bike. And I was like, well, okay, we'll get you a dirt bike. And this was before we even started racing. And
Right. You didn't have, like, a solidified program yet. So,
no.
Like, all right, a little loose here. Like, all right, yeah, we'll get you on two wheels real quick. Yeah.
Yeah, okay, we'll get you a dirt bike. And then as fate has it, you know, happened at work, we lost our bonus program, and I'm like, hey bud, we're just going to take a back seat on the bike. He's like, ah, no problem. And then when everything came back around, I was like, hey, you still want that bike? He was like, no dad, I want to race the four-wheeler. And I'm like, works for me.
I wonder
how expensive it would have been. I like pushed the bike.
Yeah, exactly. You're like, oh no, we'll get you a bike, you can start racing that. Yeah. So I gotta ask Colton, since he's here, what exactly made him want to, you know, get going to the races and all that and get that fire started?
Go ahead.
I don't know what to say.
Hey, we're working on his speech here. He kind of
don't mean to put him on the spot or anything, but you know, like, no, yeah, that's rad. Yeah, rad subject.
It's sink or swim. We're throwing him in the deep end right now, Logan.
Yeah. No doubt. I feel you on that.
But come on.
I don't like this game.
I'll start it off. So we always did, when I say always, for 2 years before we started racing, we did the fair races, mm-hmm. which – I mean, every redneck kid around here does. I mean, yep. You see it as soon as you walk through the gates. You know, they're wearing the bullet helmets and the blue jeans and the cowboy boots, and they just go out there and have a fun time. And I think his first year he raced at 90, and he did all right. And then the second year, the little shit won. Like, I couldn't believe it. I'm like, I can't believe that he's actually leading. And he led for more than one lap. And he ended up winning.
Sick.
We always wrestled, and we played baseball and football. And it was coming towards – I talked to a guy at work that raced, and he raced bikes. And I was kind of picking his brain on, you know, the different races and different series. And, you know, he told me which one. And so I went home, and I asked him, I said, what do you think about going to a quad race? And he's like, I'll try it. And we couldn't have picked a worse race to go to.
Oh, it was the worst race ever. It was snowing on our way up there. It was in a cornfield, the parking.
It was, I think it was sunshining, raining, snowing, sleeting, ice.
Mm-hmm.
And I might have even got a sunburn sometime during that day. It was
sunburn. Man.
Oh, it was the muddiest race, too.
And, so you're out in Utah, so you don't have this crazy weather like we do. I mean, maybe you do. I'm not up on my Utah knowledge, but
it hardly ever rains out here. Yeah, it's rained the most in the past month than it has in the past like 2 years.
So we pull up to this race, and I have no idea what to expect. Like I really don't. If we get there, and it is this wild cornfield, mind you, it's been raining for like a day straight, and we almost get stuck getting into the race. We get in there.
From the pit.
Yeah. Like it was crazy. There was people, like, they were pulling them in with tractors, like, just to get to their spots before the race. And
good luck getting out.
So, and I didn't have a trailer at the time, thank God. So long story short, we go there, and, like, I don't know how this all works. I try to explain to them, like, the basics. You start with your motor off, they call your line, and you go. So everybody lines up in their lines. They call it 10 seconds, the flag races. Now, mind you, we're 8 rows back. The flag raises, he takes off. I'm like, dude, I pick up his ground bar. I'm like, you can't get away.
Why are these guys going? He just starts going around them.
But
fantastic.
For short, he ended up placing second that race, his first race. And ever since then, we didn't do the full year because, you know, we were involved in football, so we had prior commitments. But
you guys stay busy, man. That's awesome. Yeah, that's how long did he play football for?
2 years, I think.
No, it's like 2-3, somewhere around there.
Yeah, 3 years. He was he's a bigger kid, so he was a lineman. So that doesn't help the horsepower issue on these little bikes either.
yeah. That's no doubt about that. It's like, holy cow, yeah, you'll end up wanting it. You'll be stoked when you get on a 450 once you're old enough.
Yeah, well, he rides mine every now and then when his is. Well, this is the first year that we have a practice bike, and thank God, because every time when his bike would be down, I wouldn't hear the end of it. Dad, can I ride the 450? Dad, can I ride the 450? And, like, I don't care that he does. I know how I was at his age, and that scares the living hell out of me. Like,
yeah.
I hear that thing hitting rev limiter, and I'm like, Where is he at?
As long as you can still hear the limiter, you know,
right.
It's all good. As long as it keeps going.
It's fun. And he does pretty good. Like, it's the dad in me that worries, but I feel that he's more capable on it than I am. So that's one good thing. But
yeah. Dad's always going to worry.
Yeah. So moving on. This year, well, actually last year, was your first pilgrimage out here to the East Coast racing GNCC at Snowshoe. And
it was.
You traveled what? It blew my mind when you told me, because I didn't think it took that long, but it was like 20-some hours?
No, dude, it was 40 hours one direction. But that was from Havasu. I mean, I drove 5 hours from St. George to get to Havasu to meet the boys. And then we got on to 40 and then went. So for me, it was 45 hours each direction, because we got to Havasu at like 9 p.m. one of the nights, or 8 p.m. or something. It was decent. And I just loaded up, and then I ended up driving to Utah that night, because I was just, you know, you just want to get home at that point. Almost there, man. Yeah, but I got back at like 2 a.m. or something. But yeah, 90 hours on the road that week. But yeah, it was worth it. Totally worth it, man. That was such a sick race.
Yeah, and that's where we finally met you, because up till that point, well, I just talked to you on the phone, and it was the first year us getting support from FASST, and we were just going through the pits, and it was me and Colton. I said, hey, there's Logan. And so we stopped, and hell, I think we talked for like an hour or so. It was good to finally like put a face with the name. And I know we talked about it, you know, up until then, and it was just good. And I have to say though, like, we have a lot of sponsors. We love all of our sponsors. We're so lucky to have the sponsors we have, but you know, for what FASST does, and mainly what you do for us, is just above and beyond. Like, it's unbelievable just the amount of support that we get from you. And I can call or text you at any time and just with the most stupid question there is, and you'll talk me through it. And that's awesome.
We're all riders and racers here, though, too, and that's, like, a huge part of it, man. So, like, honestly, dude, it comes down to all of us just, like, wanting to help, you know, here. So, I mean, we're a small business, and we do everything we can for everybody, for sure. So, yeah, man, thank you. Yeah, thanks for the kind words, seriously.
Oh, no problem. Thanks for the great products. I mean, I didn't want to get into it. I want to do a little bit more of the life of Logan before we got into the fast, but I mean, we can go back to the lifestyle of Logan. But tell us, since we're on the topic, tell us a little bit about fast. Like, we know what it is, but you know, there's probably people that listen to this that have no idea that you could probably even get different handlebars on bikes. I would hope that's not the case, but you know, there probably are. And you know,
some people don't know. Yeah.
When we were first talking, like, I was amazed when you were asking me, oh, what about the bar length? What about the rise? What about the bend? What about, and I'm like, dude, I don't know. They need two ends on it where I can hold on to it and something to put it on the bike.
Yeah. Some people, I mean, well, I'll get some calls, and sometimes people had like just heard of our brand, and it's like that one right there. I'm just like, wow, like finally heard of us. Like, that's rad. Like, kind of encouraging, you know, like there's room for growth, you know, people, not everyone in the world has heard about us, but I mean, Fast Company Flex handlebars have been around since 2001. So I mean, we're going on 22 years that the Flex bars have been out. And then since 1998 was when my boss released his first product, was the spoke torque wrench. And so, I mean, they're coming up on 25 years. I need to pin these guys down and ask exactly an anniversary date for Fast Company, but I've been around for a while, you know, so I'll get those questions here and there, or like, yeah, tell me about your bars, you know. And I mean, yeah, so telling the world, it's a flex handlebars, it's an abuse reduction system integrated into a handlebar. It's super tunable with different what we call elastomers. To put it a better explanation, they're cushions that are different stiffnesses, and you could adjust the preload on it to, you know, adjust the feel for the bar. So super rad. And I'm talking about sweeps and heights and widths and all that. We got about like 80, probably about just under 80 different variations of bar bends and, you know, combinations that we could put together to get all those different bends. But yeah, sometimes I'll get the call too, and they just, you know, the guys just want the flex handlebars inch and an eighth size. And I'm like, oh, okay. Like, you know, he thinks there's just one bend, you know? So, but I love to explain to people. I think the more info, the better. They're going to appreciate the product and like what it has to offer way more. Like, I go to think about when I had flex bars on that carbureted YFZ450, dude, I didn't know what I was doing with them. And I just had them on there. I had them rolled forward all crazy. Like, I didn't know what I was doing. So, yeah, I always just bring myself back to when I was looking from the outside. You know what I mean? I always bring myself back to that. And I'm like, okay, this is where I can help these guys. Because, I mean, you don't know what you don't know, you know? That's how I serve everybody.
That's a big thing that I always tell people, like, the guy that does my motors, Chris Shoup, I tell him, I'm like, look, dude, I understand, like, I may ask the dumbest question, but you don't know what you don't know. And you don't know it. So, like, getting into, like, all the bends and the rises, like, if somebody just came to you and said, I just needed handlebars, are all those bends and rises, is that just more fine-tuning? Like, can you start with just your basic flex bar and just go from there and not have any problems?
Yeah, you definitely can, for sure. I mean, there's enough variations where I can definitely understand, you know, some confusion and stuff like that. But, yeah, we've got, like, a bar bend chart, at least on our website. You know, we've got a lot of dealers that, I mean, we rely on. But, you know, at least on our website, we do have, like, what is closest to stock. Yeah, 12-degree moto. On the dirt bike side, 12-degree moto is definitely the most popular bar. on the ATV side, the 14-degree quad high is that's probably more popular than the 12-degree moto, just because we're more dominant in the ATV market. But mm-hmm. especially for the recreational guys, man, like, I mean, they're stoked on the high bars. Some, you know, I always bring bar heights back to rider goals. So, I mean, if you're looking to shave seconds off your lap and, you know, really want to, or looking to maximize every, like, suck every bit of performance you can get out of the quad or the motorcycle, then, I mean, yeah, totally, like, definitely aim for, like, a stock bar height, if not something a little lower. Mm-hmm. But, like, tall bars, you know, it'll add some comfort by taking some strain off the lower back, but it might, you might lose a little bit of steering and handling performance, you know, so just one of those deals. I always let people know too, like, hey man, you can always reference the pro ATV, like the XC1 line, you know, Walker Fowler, Cole Richardson, Johnny Gallagher, all these guys, you know, they're running stock height stems with our standard height, ATV bars. You know, don't want to go too tall.
You know, see, that's kind of like where I went. I went with a little bit higher stem because I've had two back surgeries. So just that giving up the couple seconds a lap and being able to walk the rest of the week is kind of like a trade-off for me.
Exactly. See, there's a bar bend for everybody. So, I mean, if you've got, you know, a couple of fused vertebrae or whatever it is, you know, or some kind of underlying condition you got to get taken care of, you know, then, I mean, yeah, there's ergos that'll fit you a little better than, you know, the mainstream ergonomics. So,
right.
Yeah. Yeah. And I just, man, that's, chatting bar bends 40 hours a week, bro. That's me.
If there's 80 choices out there, we got to have the best one. We got to. We can't sleep at night if we look at it and say, man, if I only got that other degree, he'd have passed that kid.
That's right, though. Honestly, that's the racer in all of us right there, you know. So yeah, I'm here to help make sure all my all my racers' minds are at ease here. So
and you do, like, I remember telling you when we first got fast support, and this speaks volumes to just yourself and to FASST as a company. We filled out the application and got support. And I was upfront honest with you and said, look, I really like your product. I'm going to get your product. But right now with the budget we have for the bike, it wasn't in the plan right now. And you were flat out honest with me and said, look, whenever you get them, you get them. We will support you every way that we can. I'll help you in every way that I can until you're ready to buy them. And I mean, to me, that just went above and beyond, because a lot of times, just not in the racing community, but just in life in general, if you're not buying from somebody, you're not getting any attention. They're not helping you. But you, I mean, even before I bought my first set of bars for Colton, I mean, it was like I've bought 6 or 7 bars from you, because that's how much information you got and how much you helped me with it. And I mean, that just blew me away. And that's why, you know, we're very loyal to the sponsors we have and the people that support us, and we don't take it lightly. And that's why we'll be FASST for as long as FASST is around.
Yeah, that's huge, man. But yeah, seriously, man, thank you. Like, I mean, that's, you're basically just, I mean, yeah, I mean, yeah, I mean, I get some compliments like that, like, often enough. So I'm pumped on it. And not to, like, be like, oh yeah, I'd like toot my horn. Like, no, dude, like, I totally take pride in my work, and I'm all about spending, like, I don't want anybody to, like, leave confused or, you know, receive a handlebar not knowing that that's, like, every, like, that's the bar that they need. And I would much rather them know exactly what it is too. I don't want to just, I mean, I get it when some guys are like, I have no idea, and, you know, just send me whatever you think is best. Like, I mean, I get that, you know, but, and sometimes I'm just so too slammed. I don't want to get into it with every single person, but for the most part, dude, everybody gets all the information. So it's, yeah, thank you. That's huge. Seriously. Yeah. We're stoked to support, man. We're not going to force people to buy stuff, and that's one of those things. We're happy to help as much as we can, though. So, I mean, like I was saying earlier, we're a small business as well, and yeah, it's one of those deals, man. Yeah, definitely couldn't do it without the support of our racers either.
Yeah, American made too. That's huge for us because that's our scheme, the red, white, and blue.
Yes. Yeah. You guys are super patriotic this year and last year too.
Here's something that Colton and I were talking about, and maybe you can get your guys to get on board. But how about like this year? Because last year you came out with the We the People bar pads. How about this year? We do. You guys can maybe do like a bar pad contest where we can have a bunch of people send in ideas, and the best one wins.
You know, I've had that idea. Someone let me know about that too last year, and we were doing some other. I would love to do something like that. That would be sick. I know we're on a podcast. I don't want to make any promises, but I would. That's a great idea. I think that'd be a really good thing to do.
Be careful about promising on this, because there'll be about four or five people that will listen to it, and I guarantee at least one of them will hold you to the fire on it.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I would. You know, that would be awesome. Yeah. Well, I mean, hey, man, it's, you know, it comes down to us just getting the wheels rolling. So, man, as soon as I can get freed up and whatnot, I'd love to do something like that. You know, I'm all about bringing some new. You know, we like to push our sponsored riders to run our pads too, and because some people like, or every once in a while, some guys will end up, you know, getting like a custom one printed from their graphic guy, which, whatever, you know, it is what it is. But I mean, you know, we can't control that. But you know, it's one of those deals. So we need to keep that spicy. You know what I mean? Got to keep the keep our bar pad inventory looking good. So it probably would end up being probably being a patriotic deal. Yeah. Man, that's a really cool idea. That'd get us some really good, I'm sure we'd get real positive engagement just being the brand that we are, you know. Like, we're just super involved with our community.
But, all right, so let's switch to the life of Logan. So, last year, you ran the GNCC. Usually, up until this point, have ran strictly just works. So, tell me from your perspective, what are the similarities and the differences from racing in the desert and racing in a subtropical race?
I mean, you're on you're on four wheels and you got some flex bars. That's about it. I built a woods quad. Since I found out that we were driving out there, and I kind of got it lined up to do a few more GNCCs after the snowshoe, I'm like, all right, I could leave this thing out there. Like, I'm going to build this thing and make it worth it, you know? So I put a Hauser front end on, and then I sent my Elkos out to Impact Solutions, and they got them all built for the Hauser front end. So I went out with a full wood setup. Just being a little bit narrower, the quad definitely tips over a lot easier. You can't corner it the same. and then the trees, I ain't getting used to anything. Let's be real here, but I'm getting a little more comfortable. Well, this was 3 months ago. I was at Ironman. I was definitely getting a little bit more comfortable kind of shooting some gaps between trees, but man, that's some confidence and probably just a screw I need to loosen to actually make that happen, you know? I'm like, holy cow. Like, so I don't know. It's a lot. It is a lot to soak in. And I've just been soaking in as much as I can when I go out there, because the technical riding, it is such a challenge. And I guess I'm just all about a challenge, and going back to, you know, why I started racing. Like, I just love riding. And I mean, races are just another cool way to get out and ride, dude. Like, who else, you can't go and ride snowshoe on any other occasion.
No, and you can't.
Yeah. Like, all these racetracks that we go to, you can't go to Glen Helen. You can't go to like Prim or Havasu. And the dirt is prepped. I mean, maybe not in the woods races, but you know what I mean? It's wet, you know, it's rough. You got 500, 200 quads on the track on the weekend. You get these gnarly conditions you would never experience, like out trail riding and camping, you know what I mean? So, obviously it's great to get out, you know, out like, and just ride like outside of an event, but going to an event and challenging yourself, like, it's just a rad, it is just such a good way to get like really, really good, hard, challenging riding. And, yeah, dude, all the woods races have been super hard. Definitely haven't been easy for me to make a finish, but I have finished every one of them. And, snowshoe was the only one that I didn't get all the laps, but
right.
I got stuck in a mud hole for like 15 minutes. And of course it wasn't in Howard's hole. Like there was nobody around. So yeah, it took everything I had in me to get it out of the mud hole, but I got it out all by myself. I did not drive 45 hours to get winched out. Wasn't happening. So yeah, I might have been on pace to get every lap that race at snowshoe, but hey man, it's part of the game, dude. I ended up just freaking plowing into it, sticking to the mud. So
and that's an accomplishment in itself, because so we just started racing and I am extremely late to this whole thing, and by no means am I trying to pass myself off as a racer. But I've started racing, and just completing the same amount of laps as the lead guys is an accomplishment in itself. So, I mean, congrats to you coming out from where there's no trees to a bunch of trees and pretty much on that lap.
Yeah, thank you, man. I we all have our own expectations and whatnot, but, dude, leaving every GNCC, I ended up coming back. I'm like, you know what, dude? I got all those laps in. At the Burr Oak, I was out there for 2 hours and 48 minutes or something like that. Mm-hmm. And then Ironman, it was like 2 hours and 45 or 2 hours and 40. It was like the same time. I was just like, holy crap. I was smoked, dude. I've never had to ride for that long.
it's crazy. And like for me, like I had always been naturally gifted, talented in whatever sport that I did. So
mm-hmm.
to me, like, well, I'll just hop on this bike and, you know, this is going to be crazy. I'm going to be on the podium. They're going to be like, where'd this guy come from? And I'm going to tell you that thought is in my head about 5 minutes after we left the starting line. I was like, I can't believe that I got to suffer through this for another 2 hours.
Yeah. You're like, oh, man, this is treacherous out here, dude.
Yeah. It was like, I know I can do this, but my body just won't respond at all.
Yeah. Dude, I got to say, like, for the GNCC race, like, speaking of, like, dude, it is – all those tracks are gnarly and, like – and not saying this in a bad way, dude, like, but it is dangerous out there. Like, you can't just go out there – and pull something out of your ass. You know what I mean? Like, it ain't happening, dude. The guys that are following that series and the guys that are competitive in their classes are, it's, dude, it's next to none, you know? Like,
it's crazy.
Yeah.
I mean, so we'll put this in a pecking order. There's me, then there's a bunch of other guys, and then there's you, and then you got the pros. And just to see, like, the speeds that the XC1 guys go, it blows my mind, because, like, I think I can conceptualize that speed, but I cannot when I'm out on that track. And it's like I'm going as fast as I can, and these guys are going 20 miles an hour faster. And it's like, I can't even put that in my, I can't wrap my head around that. And they just,
yeah. And they're so comfortable doing it, you know, mm-hmm. like it's, dude, it's great. The roll speed through the trees. Like, I mean, you can't just come into a turn and slam on the brakes and then get on the gas again. Like, no, dude, like their entrance, their roll speed is huge. Like, they're not slowing down, you know, like they're like the entrance to the turn is fast. Like they might slow down like a, I don't know how many miles an hour, but it's the roll speed is huge. Yeah, two. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, they're rolling though. They ain't slowing down much.
And that's like, Colton's like, are you going to ride a GNCC? And I'm like, but I have no business being on that track with any of those guys. Like, I'm let's not fool myself here. Like, I'm good with the local stuff.
No, you're not. You can barely think.
Yeah. Hey, now.
Hey, as long as he's enjoying it. That's what I was saying earlier. Like, it's dude, it's for me, like, literally, like, dude, I just love to, like, people have asked, like, that's the thing, too, like, I'm going to ride no matter what. Here's the deal, like, say, like, racing wasn't a thing, like, I'm going to ride no matter what, and it's probably just as dangerous out there in the desert, because nobody knows where I'm at, and it's not a closed course, you know, like, someone, the side-by-side could be coming the other way, and I'll get killed or whatever, and, yeah, like, dude, racing is definitely a safe, it's a safe thing to do, but it comes with its challenges. It comes with its own, you know, dangerous things. So, but it's worth it.
It's like anything. You can get killed doing anything, and I'm a firm believer that if it's your time, it's your time. So you might as well go out there and enjoy yourself and not leave anything on the table and live your life, because if you don't, you live your life not taking chances and being scared, then – I mean, are you really living at that point?
Man, you just spoke words to me, bro. No, I'm telling, like, that hit me deep, because, I mean, dude, I just did some racing at WORCS this last weekend at the opening. It was the opening round for this year, and I mean, I didn't have a really good start, and I mean, I had that up against me from the beginning. You know, I ended up finishing fifth. I think there was 10 of us, maybe 9 of us out there. But, yeah, so I was dead last on the start. And anyways, I ended up – I got to – so, yeah, just – I'll go back a little bit. Yeah, so I dead last on the start. Killer ride with Johnny Gallagher. I got to ride with him for, like, 3 laps, and it was sick, dude. Anyways, but, dude, I just was not – like, I mean, and obviously being comfortable and all that and – you know, always speaking of what, you know, everybody's level is on. Everyone's going to be on their own level, like, every race weekend. It's hard to put this into words, you know, but I was not riding as confident as I think I should be, you know. Like you were saying, like, and it's like, dude, like, I was talking to my boss about it today, dude. He's just like, dude, like, we were looking at lap times today. And, like, I was, like, 20 seconds off, 30 seconds off from Bo and Travis and a few of the laps. But, you know, and I'm just thinking about all the different sections and all that where I didn't have the throttle open and, you know, let off the throttle early and, you know what I mean, maybe a little coasting here and there. And, yeah, man, like you were saying, dude, like in our reality, like, dude, and obviously don't just send it and close your eyes. Like, Jesus, take the wheel. This is not the theory. But, man, I need to be hanging it out a little bit more, man. I'm telling you, it's, yeah, we're going to get there. Obviously a little bit of the confidence is going to come with more of these races, but I just wasn't as, it was the high speed sections when you're going like 80 miles an hour, you know, and you're like pinning it into like a little chicane with some bumps in it. Like, I slowed down, you bet your butt. I freaking threw that thing in fourth gear real quick, dude. I wasn't about to. But I know Bo and Travis were just probably just, you know, like finding one little line through there and just squeezing with their legs and freaking holding it pinned. I'll bet you it was dialed, but whatever. Yeah, we'll get there.
that's another thing that's got to mess with you too, is like your reaction time from coming out there to coming back here. Like, it's got to mess with you, because – like you just said, you're doing 80. Like, I don't know that anybody does 80 out here. Like, I'm sure.
Yeah, I don't think you guys do. Yeah, like Walker and like all those dudes, they came out here and raced the final round of WORCS last year. And like, he's just like, dude, he's like, literally like their setup was way off. And him and Mark got it dialed in, of course, because is Mark Nauman. I mean, who else to dial it in, you know?
Yeah.
So he got it dialed. Him and Walker got it dialed, but he was like, dude, that was crazy how fast they were going for the duration of time. And, I mean, yeah, that's the thing, you know. I mean, yeah, we really don't. I mean, this track this last weekend, I mean, I never put it in second gear. I mean, only when I came in and got gas, you know what I mean? Like, that was it.
But I lived, like, if I lost second gear, I think I'd probably be done. I'd call it quits.
Yeah. That'd be, man, I'd be, yeah, we'd be burning up a clutch for sure.
I actually thought about that the other day. I'm like, man, if I tear this bike apart, I bet you I look at all the other gears and they look brand new and second is just like trashed.
That's hilarious.
Then I remember talking to Walker at the GNCC one.
He took first gear out of his bike.
Yeah, he takes first gear out of his bike, and like I think them guys running like third and fourth the whole time, and I'm like, well, good for you.
First gear out of his bike?
I thought that's what he said, and I don't quote me on that. I don't want to – I'm sure if
– No, I know. You're good. It wouldn't surprise me, dude. Like, those guys are gnarly.
Yeah, like, it's just a whole nother level. Like, I got so much respect for them and their racecraft just by getting in this and watching it, and it's like – you have so much more respect when you can sit back and be honest with yourself and be like, I can't do that. And to watch somebody do that, that's when it's really, you really get respect from somebody because you can't even fathom yourself doing that. And these guys are like living it.
Yeah. Yeah. Competing it, you know, like really hanging it out. You know, while they're doing it, scrubbing whatever it is or doing whatever they're doing, it's gnarly. Like, dude, yeah, it's awesome they can ride that stuff at that pace. Like, dude, all the off camber rutted stuff that I was seeing at Snowshoe was really hard to ride, you know, and it was gnarly. And I did the GBC tire 10-hour Harlan challenge as well this year or last year. And dude, watching Walker, So Walker ended up riding like 5.5 hours. between Walker, Johnny, and Mark. They were on a team. And yeah, Johnny and Mark just filled the gaps basically. And then Walker basically did 2 GNCC races and a WORCS race. So he's crazy.
Yeah, he's an animal. I'd like to have him on here one time and just pick his brain. And what a cool dude, too, because, I mean, I don't want to turn this into the Walker show, but, you know, just a great guy. Like, when we started this, like, obviously you knew who Walker was because he was the number one guy. And up until then, like, as far as racing went, like, I wasn't exposed to racing, but I was exposed to other sports. And to me, like, if you met one top rank athlete in your career of doing whatever it was you did, like that was, you were doing pretty good, but all these riders are just so approachable. And it's like, you can't even pick a favorite one because you pick one and then you end up talking to another guy and you're like, oh man, that guy's awesome too. And then the other guy's awesome. Yeah. And that's one of the things that really drew me to this sport was everybody is so approachable. Everybody is just, they'll give you the time of day. Like it's amazing. Like what we're doing right now, like you're 2,500 miles away. We've met once and you know, it's like, we're talking like we've known each other for how long. And that just speaks volumes to the sport in itself.
It does. It definitely does. I mean, we're just, you know, obviously, like, you know, like-minded people, but, like, common interests, like, bring people together, but like-minded is also, like, I think just to be a racer, like, you also have to be like-minded. Like, you see the racers that aren't going to be around for very long.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And, you know, I hate to pick, Yeah, and I would never pick anybody out or anything, but conversating with some people and, you know, with racers that I meet along the way or, you know, whatever, they're just getting into it or, you know, maybe they were into it, now they're not anymore. You definitely know, you know, where people's minds are at, you know, whether they're driven towards, you know, towards racing or if they're caught up in outside life. And that's really what it comes down to is like, that's what that comes down. The dedication really comes down to being caught up in the outside life for sure. But it's easy to pick up like-minded people. And yeah, we got a lot of that in our community. And I don't know, not like, oh yeah, quad guys are cool and dirt bike guys aren't, but man, I know a lot more quad guys that are just totally down to earth. Got a lot of dirt bike guys buddies too that are like way cool, you know, but man, they're just more common, right? There's just more dirt bikes out there, so it just is what it is.
And we need to work on that. We need to get more of the ATVs back there, because I honestly think, like, if you can get more people exposed to this, and not necessarily just racing, but just going out there and just riding a four-wheeler, like, I think that the industry will start noticing that and they'll look at releasing some stuff. I mean, it blows my mind that, you know, Yamaha is the only one out there that still makes a 450, and there's a national class that is a 450 production class, and that's what I would like to see. And that's one of the reasons why we started doing the podcast, other than just trying to just do more within the community, but just to try and get more awareness out there so that, you know, you don't have to, the next generation of racers that are coming up aren't looking for 10-year-old bikes, because I mean, like with Colton, all there is right now, the newest bike that he can race is a 2013 that's 10 years old. And sooner or later,
that's a struggle right there.
Yeah, sooner or later, there's going to be fewer and fewer and fewer of these things, and
people are blowing them up.
And if something doesn't happen, just going to eventually just go away because there's not going to be anything to ride anymore.
Yeah, yeah, and I gotta say, man, I've been super encouraged. I don't know how big. I feel like side by sides are probably just big, like everywhere. You know, East Coast, West Coast. Obviously a little bit more desert oriented over here, you know, like, cause they're just, I mean, the pro R's and all that, the big wide cars and all that, there's a lot more, there's probably a little bit more out this way, but man, I'm starting to, I mean, the price of those things, dude, you're 30, 40 grand, you know, you can't get a decent side-by-side for less than 32,000 right now. So, you know, unfortunately, like, it just is what it is, but like, I mean, dude, people are going to start losing interest in that. You know what I mean? Like, you can only do it for so long, you know,
right.
Like there was one thing when side-by-sides were, you know, $14,000, you know, as a Rhino, obviously they're a little different now, but 20 grand was like, okay, it's feasible. Anyone could go in and buy these, but now not anyone could go out and buy them. And I mean, dude, honestly, like, dude, I go out to Sand Hollow at the lake and party and hang out with my buddies. I'm very focused as a racer, but I got to have my off time. In the summertime, I get out there and hang out with my bros, and dude, I'll see all kinds of quads riding recreationally. Dude, all the quads come out. It's super rad. Like, and it wasn't like that 3-4 years ago, but this past 2 years and last year, like, dude, there's been more quads on trailers that I've been seeing, and they're not ranchers, you know, they're sport quads. So
that's good.
It's rad. Yeah, it's rad to see. I'm like, oh, dude, look, there's some quads on a trailer right there. And, you know, that's, yeah, it's just, there was a time where you would never see that, dude. Like, there was a good, like, you know, 5 years, I feel like. You just, it's just not common.
And,
so,
I mean, thank God that the side-by-sides are priced the way they are right now, because I think that's going to help us, because, you know, we just had Ronnie Paul Wilson, the guy that runs one of our local series around here. We had him on last. And he was talking about the same thing. It's like, you if you want to get into racing the UTVs, like you're looking at 30 grand and that's before you start doing all your stuff to it. And I mean, let's face it, none of us, I mean, a lot of us make a little more money than the average person, but by the time I could not race one of those things. I couldn't support one of those. I mean, because the money, it's so much money.
Yeah, they're gnarly. And like, dude, like the, if you're, and you got to get a good car too, you know, you don't want to get something that's just, you know, 1,000 cc's kind of thing. So yeah, those, I know the guys at WORCS, dude, they change wheel bearings and hubs like every race. Even if they don't break, they'll just throw new hubs on. And all around. Axles, diffs. I think they put more than half the guys are putting new diffs on, new axles, new wheel bearings and hubs, and then probably just a bunch of little random crap here and there, you know, like Himes, and they're just more moving parts. It's, I mean, yeah, you're probably $6,000 to prep a car to get to the next round. That's what I would assume after you got it built.
See, and that just goes against too, like, and I don't race them. I've never really even rode one other than just, you know, maybe the neighbors, and it was a mule. But I can't really speak to it. The thing I like about the four-wheelers is you obviously, like, we put a lot of money into our bike, but really comes down to the person that's sitting on that bike that makes the big –
Yeah, like it comes down to the rider. Like, I'll bet you Walker or Bryson could get on a stock. Any of those guys on XC1, get on a stock Yamaha. And this is going to be it would be a challenge. It would be a big challenge for anybody getting on that quad. But they probably wouldn't be that far off of their normal pace.
No. I've seen Chris Borch race a TRX 90. Faster than most people were riding 450s, and it was just like, you got to be shitting me! Like, this guy is stock. He's like 150 pounds over the recommended weight for this thing, and he is killing people on it. And it just, I don't think you could do that on. I think if the UTVs may come down to more of a performance-based machine than it is rider. Now, don't get me wrong, you still got to know how to ride it to be able to finish up top, but I think I don't think the same can be said, like you just said.
Yeah, for sure. Like, a lot of it's definitely more money racing, you know what I mean? Like, I mean, you see a lot of guys that don't really know anything about off-road just get into racing UTVs, you know? Like, I mean, I've met a few guys like that, and I'm like, oh, wow, like, that's picked a cool sport, I guess, you know. I'm like, okay, like, he's got some different problems that we all like, okay, like, that's rad. Like, he's all in, he's got four cars and he's ready to race, dude. Like, that's sick, like, super rad, you know. Like, good for those dudes, you know. It's I honestly, like, so I used to work on those things when I worked at I was a Can-Am guy when I worked over at Moto Zoo before Fast Companies. So I've done my fair share of wrenching on side by sides. I just, I don't think I'd have any interest either, but one of those deals.
Maybe we can get them started in the UTVs. They can see how much money it costs and they'll still have the bug, and then they'll switch over to ATVs.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. We'll have a couple of those, I'm sure.
We'll take it however we can get it.
Yeah, I'm all about growing the sport, man. Like, as a rider, as a racer, as an athlete, you know, whatever it may be, just as a person, as your rep over at Fast Company, man. Yeah, definitely just trying to grow the sport, and if you want to see it around for a long time, man.
Yeah, absolutely. But so we're closing in on an hour now, and I appreciate every minute of it. And but I think I should probably let you go, because it's 7 o'clock your time?
Yeah, it's 7. You're good, bro. Yeah, I'm pretty. Yeah, well, we can always, you know, we can come back to this too. So yeah, we have another. Whenever fit me in.
It won't be the last time I want to have you on here, because, like I said, you're one of our favorite people, and Fast as well. So I mean, definitely want to have you back on here again. But I'll let you get on with your night. We got to get ready for school tomorrow, although he thinks he's going to have a snow day tomorrow.
They said that it was possible.
That's so funny, yeah. Hey, you never know, dude. It snowed here, and it snowed here like two nights ago. We never get snow, so, hey, I'll keep my fingers crossed for you, buddy.
But, yeah. So thanks for taking some time out tonight, Logan. And like I said, we'll get you back on here again. And I just really appreciate everything that, you know, you do for us and you do for the racing community. And, yeah, we'll have you on again. And we'll see you out here this year for a couple of GNCCs as well.
Yes, sir. Yeah, yeah. I'll be out there and I'll be out there and come hang out. And, yeah, bro. No, it goes hand in hand, man. Yeah, thank you for having me, and thanks for all your support. It's I'm pumped to be your second guy. So heck yeah.
All right, man. Well, you take care, and I'll be talking to you, man.
All right, John. That sounds good, man. All right, see you, Colton. See you, John.
See ya.
Bye.
Later. About the joker and the thief, I said. I'll tell you all the story about the joker and the thief, I said. That was all about the-